I'm here to tell you about Biomine. But more specifically, I'm here to tell you about my ex. So all of us here in this room today have one thing in common. We all believe in breakthrough technologies being the way forward to help solve grand challenges. Be it IT revolutions, be it mobile revolutions, clean technologies, healthcare, knowledge revolutions. But two of the inadvertent paradigms that are resulted from these technology revolutions are, on one hand, an exponentially increasing electronic waste stream and a critical shortage of the metals and materials and resources that go into fueling these technologies. And this is where my ex comes in, which I've called resource reclamation, but what I'm trying to find a solution for really is a way to make the technology revolutions of tomorrow actually sustainable. And this was an opportunity we came across at Singularity University, so thanks, Peter. So Moore's Law is actually integrated into every part of our life today. As technology grows faster and cheaper, our consumption has exponentially increased in the last decade. But what's equally increased is the obsolescence rate in these technologies. And we call this the dark side of Moore's Law. If you look at the 3.2 million tons of e-waste that are generated by consumers in the US today, over 80% is currently landfilled. And of the 20% that's actually collected, the majority is sent to places like Bangalore, Accra, Guiyu in China. This is actually a photo of Guiyu, which is the e-waste capital of the world, which currently receives 1.5 million tons of e-waste from the US. This is an image of a woman who's actually using open burning techniques to try and extract residual value from e-waste. What she doesn't realize is she's breathing in dioxins and furans that are going to kill her. Guiyu is the second most polluted place on the planet after a nuclear disaster site. 88% of the people in this village have neurological disorders, and the people here have 256 times the level of lead in their blood compared to neighboring towns. So with over 100 million tons of e-waste predicted in 2025, is this a humanitarian catastrophe? At Biomine, we believe it's a tremendous economic opportunity. So, as a corollary to all of this massively increasing volumes of e-waste, what we realized, and people are beginning to see, is that e-waste is a highly concentrated source of metals. This is a complicated graph, but the message here is, if you look at a ton of gold ore, for example, it contains about 2 to 3 grams of gold. If you look at a ton of circuit boards within e-waste, they contain up to 500 grams of gold. Not to mention copper, silver, palladium, and a lot of rare earth elements. What does that actually mean? So a single ton of circuit boards is worth about $26,000. And when you compare that with the various ore streams that you find, it's an order of magnitude more valuable. And then when you start looking at rare earth elements, which is then everything that has an on and off switch today, at the rate of current consumption, the supply is going to fall short of demand in 2 years. When you look at a single megawatt wind turbine, it contains the same amount of neodymium, which is a rare earth element, as 2,000 tons of neodymium ore. And yet, the global recycling rates for rare earths today is less than 1%. So as we discovered this opportunity and this juxtaposition of really, really high volumes of a waste stream being generated online, and a really high concentration of value within it, we decided to look at what actually is happening today. So of the 20% that's collected today, just 20%, 4% of the total e-waste in the US is just basically recycled here, dismantled, but all of the high value stuff actually goes overseas. So we here in the US pay for stuff to be manufactured, pay for it to be imported, pay for it to be used, and then sent back, and don't recover the value. And there's only 5 compliant e-waste smelters in the world, none of them in the US. and all of them use pyrometallurgical technologies, which essentially mean massive smelters which have some residual capacity to use e-waste. And they currently use less than 5% of e-waste. And so smelting is inadequate, primarily because these are massive, massive capital needs. And more importantly, for the ever-increasing stream of electronic waste, it's not feasible to build new smelters because their feedstock capacity needs are tremendous. And when you look at e-waste, you've got the opposite of ore. It's highly concentrated, very low volumes. And that's a key point to be made. What you need, what you have is a distributed problem, and what you need is a distributed solution. In fact, talking to one of the key smelters, what we heard was the biggest and most strategic area of innovation is around logistics because e-waste is spread everywhere, and accessing e-waste is a problem. So what we decided was to come up with a distributed solution for a distributed problem. And what we're doing is decentralized mining of electronic waste. This is a picture of Rio Tinto. It's a Rio Tinto basin in Spain. And what you see here is metals that have been leached out of solution. And this is a cradle of industrial biohydrometallurgy, which essentially what it means is you've got acid-loving organisms, acidophiles, which exist naturally within soils. And what they create is an acidic environment that leaches metals out of ores. This technology has been commercialized, and over 25% of the world's copper is extracted using biohydrometallurgy, with over 90% recoveries at industrial scale. And it actually has a second purpose, which is biooxidation. So not only are you leaching base metals such as copper out of solution, you're actually creating very concentrated streams of precious metals, which are in much, much smaller volumes. And so I could take you through a boring process flow diagram, but I figured pictures are worth thousands of words. And so we're working with technology partners on pilots that have already been built. And what this shows is shredded circuit boards, which is the first feedstock that we're targeting. We believe in start small, make money, and then grow big. These are bioleaching reactors that essentially allow copper and base metals to be leached into solution. Essentially, because you have long residence times with organisms, you have multiple reactors to allow leaching into solution. You've got filtration systems which allow essentially taking all of the residual stuff and compressing it into a filter cake, which contains the precious metals which you can access out of, and you can recycle the epoxy plastics. Solvent extraction to basically make the streams much more concentrated, the streams of copper and metals. Electrolysis and copper deposition at cathode. And for us, the most important thing was to have a really simple solution. I fundamentally believe the hardest problems can be solved by simple solutions. It's not by necessarily rediscovering chemistry and biology. It's applying existing chemistries and biologies. Once we figured out what we were striving for as the technology solution, we decided to step back and look at the marketplace as a whole. So after solving the technology problem, the biggest thing that needs to be addressed is the sourcing problem. Because accessing e-waste, particularly once it's been dismantled, when you've got circuit boards, has to be at cost. And what we decided to do was, while we were focusing on the high-value refining, we decided to find partners on the front end, and these are people who are already engaged in basic disassembly and recovery of basic commodities, plastics, iron, steel. This is all established. Everyone likes to see numbers. The most beautiful part of what we're doing is that it's capital efficient because you're building really, really small plants which have very low capital needs and providing a high margin opportunity for extraction of key materials and resources. If you actually think about it, this resembles something that we've all seen before, or a lot of us may have been, a lot of, I wasn't, but a lot of the people here may have been alive for, Nucor. Nucor is one of the biggest recycling companies in the US. And what they did was capitalized on a high demand for steel, recognized an exponentially growing automotive scrap stream, and their disruption, which Clay Christensen's written about, distributed mini mills. So small facilities that extract value from highly concentrated feedstocks. And that's essentially what we're trying to do. We're using electronic scrap as feedstock, accessing technology metals, and building distributed mini refineries enabled by existing mining technologies. And as we map the future, today we're starting off with PCBs seeking to access copper and precious metals. We're working on pilot validation, but our vision 10 years from now is to essentially access all of the waste streams generated in electronics and clean technologies, essentially be the future of modern mining as we access rare, base, and precious metals to fuel technology revolutions of tomorrow. Thank you.
Let us define X. X is a solution to a seemingly insurmountable problem, like climate change or cancer, one that affects the world. But what if we redefine X as a challenge, an opportunity for radical thinking, a chance to light up the world with breakthrough ideas and cutting-edge technology, the stuff of science fiction that just might fly after all? Solving for X requires wonder and imagination and the vision to build seemingly impossible solutions to the world's biggest problems. Solve for X. Moonshot Thinking.